And just feel the in and out as you breathe. Feel whatever ground beneath you that roots you into your purpose, your ancestors at your back. And allow yourself to just be still for 1 second. And I invite you to be fully present in the space. Are we here? Yeah? Well, just a couple of opening things as we start. I like to do that because there's, in conferences like this with this many people, we're in constant motion. We're trying to get all the things done that we need to get done, meet all the people we need to meet. And that's important. And it's also important to remember one of my favorite sayings is we're human beings, not human doings. And part of the system and how it wins is making us think our worth is solely in what we do versus in our inherent worth of who we are, right? So just remembering that a little bit as we get into this space. So who here, yesterday there was a call from Alandria of, we all say we want to get free, but what does free really look like? Did anybody here get a sense today in whatever way that you had a little bit clearer of a peek of what free looks like for you and your communities? Anybody? Yeah? Zoom workshops and tracks. So I want to just give a thank you to some of the workshop presenters and track leaders. So we have, as we said yesterday, we're trying to make our space accessible. I believe our interpretation equipment, there's a little bit of a holdup. So we are going to do some consecutive interpretation right now.
Al parecer, como habíamos dicho ayer, nosotros queremos que nuestras reuniones sean inclusivas de todas las personas. En estos momentos estamos teniendo problema con el equipo de interpretación, entonces lo que vamos a hacer es una interpretación continua.
Alrighty, so we thank the workshop presenters and track coordinators. you coming up top of there? Okay. Here we go. This is all emergent design and emergent support for each other, right? So, yeah. Thank you, to interpreter.
Okay. Todo esto es preparado con emergencia y estamos todos ayudándonos el uno al otro. ¿Qué se seguimos?
So we thanked our workshop presenters and our track coordinators. Remember yesterday, Aaron and Franchelle gave us a little bit of an insider look to Buffalo. So who got to meet Buffalo a little today?
Recuerden que ayer estuvimos hablando un poquito de todo lo que estabas pasando y Eric y Franchelle estaban hablando un poquito de lo que es el estado de Buffalo. ¿Quiénes de los que están aquí pudieron estar andando en el estado, conocer a Buffalo?
Excellent. So let's give it up for our shuttle drivers and our tour guides and everyone who are in the back of making those tours happen.
Un aplauso para las personas que manejaron y los que manejaron las guaguas también por el buen trabajo que hicieron.
Thank you. Okay, I think we're back on. Okay. So one of the things that we talked about last night was sovereignty, and a good friend of mine, Kriya Gomez in Oakland, raises 6 children and runs a school in Oakland, and she always talks about no one is coming for us, so how do we come for ourselves and each other? And as we were on that tour for Buffalo, at least I know in my tour, I saw how folks were coming for each other, right? And how we think about this sovereignty and how we put our hands into the things that we want for our people and not wait for anybody else. So who here did a little bit of that today and saw how you could do that more in your community? Yeah? A little bit? Who is ready to hear about how that looks like in other places on this earth? Yeah? Who's ready to hear some of that? And because not all of us had access to the tours, who's ready to hear how that's rooted in place here in Buffalo for how they're taking care of each other? No. So that is what we are up to tonight with the charge of how do we risk together and how do we ask the hard questions of each other. So I'd like to invite up our first panel of the plenary, which is our international panel, who is going to blow your minds with what is happening in the rest of the world for how we can be together in this new economy. Let's give it up for them, please. Give them a lovely welcome.
Okay, hi everybody. Great, this is gonna be a fantastic panel. We're gonna hear about some fairly large scale examples of new economy, solidarity economy, innovative practices from Quebec, from Italy, from El Salvador, and Cuba. And the idea is we will hear about what's happening, we'll hear about what are some of the critical factors that made these developments possible, what are some of the current struggles, and if we have time, one message to the U.S. audience. And we're going to be doing consecutive interpretations, so you're going to have to be a little bit patient. It'll slow us down a bit. I'm going to pass a mic, and people are going to just introduce themselves. I think that was done so that I wouldn't butcher people's names. So why don't you start?
I'm Nancy Neamtan from Quebec, Chantier de l'économie sociale.
Federica Bandini from Italy. I am a teacher in the University of Bologna.
I'm Roberto Lepre, but I'm just the interpreter for Federica.
Buenas tardes, Oscar Recinos de El Salvador.
Good evening, everybody. Oscar Recinos Morales from Salvador.
Hello, I'm Rafael Betancourt from Cuba. I teach at the University of Havana, and I work in a project called Socially Responsible Enterprise in Local Development in Cuba, and I'm the Cuba coordinator for that project.
And I'm Emily Kawano. I'm the coordinator of the U.S. Solidarity Economy Network, and I'm also on the board of RIPES, which is the Intercontinental Solidarity Economy Network. Okay, we have a pretty short amount of time, so we're going to try to hold fast to time limits. And we're going to start with a question of what's happening? What's your story? What's your example? So we're starting with Nancy.
Yeah, I have 6 minutes to resume 30 years of my life and to talk to you about a movement that is a growing movement for the transformation of our economic development model. Perhaps just a couple of words about Quebec, even though it's very close to you. It's important to know that Quebec is a small French-speaking nation within the Canadian Confederation of 8 million people. And to survive as a nation, we've had to develop a political culture of working collectively, of social dialogue that has made it perhaps a more favorable context to grow the social and solidarity economy movement. Though it's been a lot of hard work and a lot of grassroots organizing to get where we are today, and we've still got a long way to go. Some examples: that the largest financial institution in Quebec is a cooperative. The labor movement is at a 38% rate of organization of the labor force, and the role, the social policy for women, for example, makes Quebec probably one of the places where women have the most equal rights of probably any place in the world. So we have lots to be proud of that's come out of a lot of struggle. I'm here to talk to you about the social economy movement, which I've had the privilege to be part of since it started at a grassroots level over 30 years ago. I was a community activist or community organizer working in one of the poorest neighborhoods in Canada, an old industrial area, working on trying to solve all the social problems that our community was facing, and realized with others that the problem was that the economic development model was creating constantly more poverty and marginalization, and if we didn't attack that issue head on and start developing an economy that worked for our community and benefited our community, that we would never solve the social problem. And that was the time, I'm talking about the early 80s with the Reagan, that was the beginning of Reaganism and Thatcherism, of what was called the trickle-down effect, which was to say, take away all the barriers for private enterprise, they will create wealth, and the wealth will trickle down. Notice they never said it would flow down, even in the best of times. It would trickle down. And of course, we looked at what was going on. We were 10 minutes away from downtown Montreal, and nothing was trickling down. And so we said, well, we've got to get involved in economic development for our citizens. We were, of course, crazy people at the time. one of the advantages of getting older is that 30 years later, the IMF and the OECD have said what? Trickle-down effect has not worked. Never had so much wealth creation in the world today, and the gaps between the rich and the poor have never been so huge. So we have got to go slower, yeah. So we, within the community movement, the social movement, but also within the labor movement at that time, there were some major debates on what do we do about this. And the decision that was made collectively after much discussion was to say that we have to define ourselves as economic actors. And we have to reappropriate the economy and make it work for our community. And so that's what we started doing, and we just put our heads down and start to push forward. 6 minutes, I'm going to fast forward 33 years. and to say that today I have the privilege of working with an organization that is known, very widely known in Quebec, called the Chantier de l'économie sociale. Chantier means a working group, sort of, but it really means a construction site, literally, and we've kept that because that's what we feel we're doing, is constructing a new economy, a new democratic and inclusive economy. We are a national organization that brings together networks of cooperatives and nonprofit, collectively owned enterprises, be they parent-controlled daycare, worker co-ops, housing co-ops, recycling, nonprofit recycling businesses, and so on. We also bring back together organizations working in rural and urban communities to revitalize communities for the benefit of their people, and social movements, the labor movement, the women's movement, community movements. I only have 2 minutes left, unbelievable. And the Shanti's mission is to promote and develop the social economy as part of a new economic development model. First Nations are also part of our structure. And to do that, I'm going to take a couple of minutes more. I'm sorry, I just can't get it all in. We've done a lot of things, but the main thing we've done is to figure out how we can create the conditions so that in communities across Quebec, no matter where you are, a First Nations community in an urban area, that you have the tools to be able to develop the kind of economy that is responding to the needs and aspirations of your community. It means creating a whole ecosystem, which we've done over the years, and we're still working on finance tools, training tools, research, knowledge transfer, commerce, getting out to markets, building our buying power, and to be able to let that happen, and it has had incredible results. But it's also, we worked on public policy to the extent that in 2013 we were able to win, and this was unanimously passed by our National Assembly, framework legislation that recognized that the social economy is an integral part of the socioeconomic infrastructure of Quebec. And from now on, public policy has to take into account collectively owned enterprises whose mission is not to make shareholders rich, but to make communities healthier and stronger and more sustainable. So I guess I got to stop there, except to say that we've worked internationally with a lot of you people out there. And I think that one of the key things for us has also been being part of an international movement, because we know that with the globalization of the economy, we're not going to create an utopia alone in our area. We have to all work together, and hopefully we can continue this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Nancy.
Really.
Federica.
Good afternoon. Ringrazio gli organizzatori per avermi invitato. Mi sono chiesta come mai mi avessero invitato. L'ho scoperto solo questa mattina e sono contenta. Secondo me avete fatto molto bene perché rappresento un paese che è molto all'avanguardia su questo tema.
She was wondering why she was invited. She just realized that why she was invited this morning, but she thinks that you did a good thing to invite her, because she represents a country, being Italy, and a region, being Emilia-Romagna, that is one of the most active regions in Italy about social companies.
Quest'anno il mio paese, con il nuovo Prime Minister, ha fatto una legge, una nuova legge sull'impresa sociale, dopo 20 anni che non veniva realizzata nessuna legge su questo tema.
After 20 years in Italy, there's been there's a new law about social companies that's been just established right now, And so there is a lot of expectation about the growth of social company starting last year.
Ho capito perché mi avete invitato, perché a Forlì, che è una sede dell'Università di Bologna, c'è un corso sul management dell'economia sociale, e Forlì è la città dove è nata l'impresa sociale in Italia. La nostra aula magna è intestata al primo cooperatore sociale in Italia e credo che sia una delle poche università di economia al mondo che ha l'aula magna intestata a un cooperatore sociale.
The town of Forlì, which is near Bologna, which is in Emilia-Romagna in Italy, like the center north part of Italy, has a lecture hall, which is the main hall that's been entitled to the founder of the first social cooperative in Italy, and which is a big thing because we think it's not common that a main hall of a university can be okay. Can you hear me better now? I'm sorry. Can be entitled to a social company entrepreneur.
An economic university.
Right. I'm sorry.
Sorry.
Emilia-Romagna is where they say they're the best kindergarten in the world.
And they are, sono cooperative sociali.
And those kindergarten are social companies, so social cooperatives.
Yes, it's really different. Vorrei presentarvi alcuni numeri della mia regione. E del caso appunto dell'Emilia-Romagna per quanto riguarda la cooperazione sociale. L'85% dei cooperatori sociali, dei lavoratori delle cooperative sociali hanno dei contratti a tempo indeterminato, il che significa che possono fare progetti per il futuro e possono fare acquisti, possono pagare interessi alle banche, possono costruire il loro futuro.
These are a couple of slides of data which are in English, so very easily understandable. It's just numbers, but it's indicative that 85% of employees has a permanent contract so they can plan their future in the social cooperatives.
Il 22% sono lavoratori stranieri e questo significa essere molto inclusivi verso le persone che vengono. In questo momento c'è una grande immigrazione dal paese del Nord Africa e vengono coinvolti nelle cooperative sociali.
Another important data is that 22% of the social cooperative workers are foreign, and this is very important for the integration of people.
From North Africa.
From North Africa.
Il 33% hanno dei contratti part-time, il che significa consentire loro di mantenere l'equilibrio work and life balance nelle diverse fasi di vita.
33% of these employees have part-time jobs in the cooperatives, which means that they can have a good balance between work and life.
In Italia c'è anche il fenomeno del workers buyout cooperativo. Ci sono state 56 nuove COP solo in Emilia-Romagna negli ultimi 5 anni grazie al fenomeno del workers buyout cooperativo, cioè si sono salvate imprese trasformandole in cooperative.
Another important point is the fact that 56 new cooperatives in Emilia-Romagna were born by buying out workforce, which means that they saved something like 1,200 jobs by the creation of these cooperatives.
In Italia ci sono, in Emilia-Romagna ci sono 4.500.000 abitanti su un totale di 56 milioni in Italia e abbiamo 800 cooperative di lavoratori e 800 cooperative sociali.
The country of Italy has 56 million people, 4,500,000 people live and work in Emilia-Romagna, and 800 cooperatives are present in Emilia-Romagna, which is a large
worker
number.
Cooperatives.
Worker cooperatives.
And 800 cooperative sociali.
So 800 social cooperatives and 800 worker cooperatives are in the territory of Emilia-Romagna altogether.
Okay, the last one.
Molto
importante, il per quanto riguarda l'income nelle cooperative è cresciuto tra il 2008 e il 2014 del 3,6%, mentre nelle corporates è diminuito del meno 3,1%. Il lavoro nelle cooperative è aumentato del 9,4% e nelle cooperative del 3, scusate, nelle corporates del 3,3%.
This is a slide that shows the growth of income of cooperative versus corporates. The growth of income is 3.6% versus minus 3.1, and the employees are grown by nearly 10% in the cooperatives as compared to 3.3% in the companies in
Federica,
altogether, which is a big growth.
Could you just quickly explain the difference between a worker co-op and a social co-op? And also, I just want to point out the time.
The most part of cooperative of a social enterprise in Italy are social cooperatives, because the new law about social enterprise is now. So we haven't really social enterprise. The social enterprise are cooperative, social cooperatives. Okay, we don't call social enterprise the enterprise with corporate social responsibility. For us, social enterprise have a particular characteristic, like workers are the owner of the society and so on, inclusion, link with the community and so on. So for instance,
Until now,
the real social enterprise in Italy are cooperatives.
Because of the new law that just started, so until now they're all.
Perhaps in the future we would have a new social enterprise different from social cooperatives, but in our country it's very strong, the culture on cooperatives.
Thank you. Thank you. Oscar.
Buenas tardes. Mi nombre es Oscar Recinos. Voy a hablar un poco de El Salvador, de la historia del cooperativismo en El Salvador, en un contexto.
I thought he was going to finish the sentence. Good evening, everyone. My name is Oscar Morales from El Salvador. I'm going to talk about co-ops in my country in the context.
Okay. Nosotros, mi organización nació en 1985. Bajo un contexto de un conflicto armado, donde era un poco difícil desarrollar el cooperativismo, pero para nosotros la lucha primeramente fue defender la tierra, porque había una concentración de la tierra en aquellos años en 14 familias, y luego en los 80 hubo una reforma agraria que le facilitó a los colonos darle la tierra, pero como una medida.
I'm gonna talk about the context in which the co-op was developed. It was developed in 1985 in a small town. It was about 14 families that were over there around the 80s. All of them got together in the terms of the agrarian reform in the agriculture.
O sea que se desarrolló un movimiento cooperativo, pero no con el propósito de que las familias resolvieran su problema económico, sino con otros intereses de política, de geopolítica, podemos decir. Entonces, desde el Estado en los años 84, 87, se definieron leyes para terminar con las cooperativas, porque el modelo allá era de colectivo en cuanto a la tenencia de la tierra, a diferencia de otras regiones del mundo.
And then over there we started to develop COPs in terms of the economy, not in the common sense that everybody was doing it, but in terms of the economy, but for the entire community that we were having. And then we started to do, the community started to develop some other things.
Entonces un mecanismo para dividir era una ley de parte del Estado que obligaba a que se dividiera la tierra, y eso era para que después llegaban los compradores, acaparadores, y uno a uno ir comprando la tierra, y así se perdió mucha tierra.
The way they were doing it at that time is that they were dividing the land. They divided it in a one by one situation, and then at one point they were doing that because then at some point some others were buying the land.
Oh, bueno, esa, como hay mucha historia, pero esa es una primera batalla, lograr sobrevivir ese proceso de tener la tierra, legalizarla.
That was a very long, that is another story, but it's a very, very long, and it was a long, long battle that we had to fight to finally legalize the land.
Después, como en ese periodo de la guerra las cooperativas quedaron endeudadas, hicimos otra lucha a partir de los acuerdos de paz del año 92, en el que pedimos una condonación de la deuda agraria y bancaria, que se nos condonó el 85%.
Then at that moment, after all that of buying the lands, all the co-ops, they were left behind with a huge debt that they have to pay. Then after that, we started to kind of ask if that debt could be some sort of forgiven.
Entonces, una primera batalla es lograr defender la tierra. La segunda es liberarla de las deudas. Y luego el tercer proceso después es comenzar a producir en un ambiente ya más, relativamente más tranquilo, aunque...
Okay, so we have three battles that we have to do. First, it was to pay the debt, then the land, then the second one was to give it to the people so they can start producing, and then the final one to start growing and finally producing.
Entonces, nuestro camino en el sistema cooperativo salvadoreño ha sido muy cuesta arriba, de lucha tras lucha, porque en mi país tener tierra es como la amenaza permanente de quererte despojar de la tierra. Entonces hemos pasado, muchas cooperativas se quedaron en el camino, pero los que logramos pasar estamos ahora en un ambiente diferente, donde generamos empleo a nuestras familias.
It has been difficult, you know, if you are in this, the business of the land, the growing farmers, that is a thing that is going up and down. But we have been able to do good and continue. Many co-ops, they were left behind, but some others we were able to survive and continue.
Porque para nosotros el éxito no solo es económico, porque muchas familias en mi país donde no tienen donde hacer su casa, acceder a unos metros de tierra, ya es un triunfo. Y luego pasar a la parte más social, porque las cooperativas tenemos un enfoque solidario en el que tratamos de solucionar y buscar salida a todos los problemas.
You see, in for us, the economy is not only to have something. It's a little bit more than that. It's to be able to socialize and to have a little bit more, not just the piece of the land.
Y hoy tenemos cooperativas que generan empleo a sus socios, se reparten excedentes,
Hay muchas cosas que decir, pero con el tiempo que tenemos, es bien ir salto por salto, pues no llevar el proceso, pero quiero decir que nuestra experiencia de trabajo para los pobres, la mejor opción que hay es organizarse en cooperativa o bajo otro modelo que genere ayuda mutua.
I want to say that the co-ops that we have right now, they have been able to succeed. They gave jobs to other workers, and they have been able to have good jobs. And that is something that we want to continue. We have a place of solidarity, something that we can continue giving on. And that is something that we want to continue developing.
En 30 segundos que me quedan, voy a decir que también somos miembros de Vía Campesina Internacional, donde trabajamos temas de soberanía alimentaria como un derecho que tienen los pueblos a producir su propia comida y que no se ve la alimentación como mercancía, sino como un derecho que tiene la población para nutrirse, porque hay muchos alimentos en el mundo, pero millones de gente están pasando hambre y eso no puede seguir así. Entonces, en Vía Campesina decimos un eslogan, globalicemos la lucha, globalicemos la esperanza.
Okay. I also want to say with these 30 minutes that I have is that I also work in a co-op that is called Villa Campesina, that it works with people and it seeks food not only as an intake, but also as a way of living. And it contributes to a more global institution, international institution that goes on. Okay. And they also have a slogan that is called, we need to globalize the fight, we need to globalize the hope.
Thank you, Oscar. And our last speaker is Rafael. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Good evening. In 6 minutes, I'm going to try to convince you that Cuba's socialist economy is a new economy, that Cuba's socialist economy is an alternative economy, and that in the terms of Latin America, it is a social and solidarity economy. Now, a lot of people have discounted Cuba's as a dinosaur of Soviet times, and they have failed to see the process that we have undertaken in the last 10 and 15 years. Even within Cuba, these concepts of social and solidarity economy are not well accepted by the politicians. Even in academia, there's a lot of discussion because social and solidarity economy is a problem of the capitalist countries that have to develop within the context of neoliberal exclusion, and then the social and solidarity economy fills in this place. So it has nothing to do with us. We are a socialist country. On the other hand, the left is saying, this socialism is old time, it has nothing to do with what we are building now. Well, they're both wrong. So I would argue, first of all, that a socialist economy is a social and solidarity economy scaled up at a national level. Because it's, first of all, what is it based on? It's based on an economy that puts people first and not profit. This is what we do in our country. The second is that the property that you try to control, the property of the capitalist class, in Cuba, the major property is in the hands of the people, it's in the hands of the public. And I'm talking about 3/4 of all agricultural land. Some of it may be farmed by private farmers, by cooperatives, but 3/4 of the agricultural land is in public hands. It's the natural resources under, above, and below the earth, and the coastal systems, the coasts, the water resources, the main infrastructures, the main industries, and the basic services are maintained and supported in a public manner, accessible to all, the education and health, for example, comprise 30, the public services, some 37% of our GDP. And just education and health absorbs about 27% of our GDP. So we assure security in terms of health and education. This is part of the goals of the new economy. This is part of the goals of the social and solidarity economy. Now, a lot of that is managed by the state, by state companies, and there we got a big issue. There we have a lot to resolve. There we have a lot to make more efficient. But listen, you can improve the management, but once the property is in private hands, you can only take it away by expropriation, and that's a battle, if not a war. So at least we have the first part of it. We have it in public hands. Secondly, we have a private economy and a cooperative economy that has been growing in response to the change in the model, the modernization of the model that has recognized that the state cannot be involved in everything and cannot solve all the problems. So there has been an increase in the private sector. Some 500,000 people formally have licenses to operate as private workers, plus another 600,000 farmers. So we're talking about formally about 28-30% of the labor force is private or cooperative, but it really, when you add the informal workers and the double counting, we're probably talking between about 40% of the labor force, and it eventually will come down to about 50%. So we're talking about half of the labor force is going to be working in private or cooperative sectors. Now, the cooperatives are of two kinds. There is the agricultural cooperatives, which have existed for a very long time, and the new industry and service cooperatives, which are an experiment, and they're in the process of development. And it is something that we need to work on because we need to expand that sector. But it is there. We are working in that sector, and this prevents the concentration of wealth in private hands, because those private workers have small businesses and they have limited capacity to become large businesses. For example, home ownership. You can't own a home in Cuba because you're not a resident. And I can only own two homes, one principal home and one summer home or one vacation home. So that the ownership of, for example, land and buildings is restricted in favor of a public economy, a social economy, and without the growth of the private sector uncontrolled. And finally, what have we done from our project, socially responsible enterprise and local development in Cuba? First of all, we want to put SSC in the map in Cuba, because we think it's important, because this economy is changing. It's a mixed economy where the share of the private sector is growing. So now it's more important than ever that we incorporate some of the goals and some of the struggles of the social and solidarity economy, because we are also facing the inequality that this marketization produces, and we're also facing grassroots demand for empowerment. And we're also trying to put Cuba on the global social and solidarity economy map, because we think we have a lot to contribute. Not only to learn, we have a lot to contribute. So I'm telling you, we're here. We're not absent.
Thank you. Thank you, Rafael. I want to make one comment. A clarification about social solidarity economy absolutely would not say socialism has nothing to do with us. We would say democratic forms of socialism, yeah, absolutely. So I just want to make that clear. All right, so everybody complained about it, but you did so well with your 6 minutes that I'm gonna cut it for the next round. You have three. So the next question is, what is a couple critical factors that enabled your success?
Well, the first thing is reappropriating the very sense of what the economy is. When I started as a community organizer, I really thought the economy was an exact science. I believed economists and the stock market, you know, sort of that was where the economy happened. To realize that the economy is a Greek word that comes from order in the house, which is why women have to get involved in the economy, by the way. And so the whole issue of reappropriating the economy and taking it back as our own has been an important thing. You know, we talk a lot about occupying Wall Street. Well, our vision has been, it's good to occupy Wall Street, but it's most important is to occupy the economy. And to do that, we've built, we've worked on building an ecosystem of all the different kinds of tools that you need to develop the economy, but based on our values, controlled by the movement. So if you get into financial instruments, we're talking about a whole new economic logic and financial logic, and mainly controlled by those who are using the capital, because the problem with the system today is those who control capital decide how the world, how development takes place, and it should be us doing development that decide how capital is being used. Another thing that's been really important for, so this ecosystem has been really important. We've also, you know, looked at government and seen how government has supported the private sector and multinationals, and all we say is, look, we want a level playing field. You're supporting them, you got to support us, but based on our reality. And look what we can do. We've always been very working towards government to show that we can create employment, create wealth, create economic activity by responding to the needs and aspirations of our communities, and the results are there, and every time we can show those results, we get stronger. We've also felt really strongly, and we've learned from the history of the old cooperative movement, of the importance of staying very close to social movements, because, you know, the cooperative movement started at the same time as the workers' movement as a reaction to capitalist exploitation. To defend workers with the labor unions and to control the means of production through cooperatives. And over the years, those large cooperatives really have lost their soul, and some have really no longer are cooperatives. So we felt really strongly of always working and integrating in our very governance structures social movements to be part of a movement for transformation. And the last thing is international learning. We have learned so much, a lot of you don't know that, but from experiences in the States, social cooperatives were an inspiration for us in our what we call solidarity cooperatives. And so building the international movement and learning, and I think in the social and solidarity economy, it's a place where the North has way more to learn from the South than vice versa. And so we've worked a lot on learning from our colleagues in Latin America, in Asia, and whatever. And I'm going to get my plug in if I still have 30 seconds, which is we've also, because we're a small place that has a pretty strong movement, we've played a big role in building international workers and in convening people from across the world. We did it in 2011 with people from 63 countries, 1,500 people. We are convening in September, the beginning of September, the Global Social Economy Forum. We have already people from over 53 countries coming. So I hope that there's going to be a good delegation from the States. It's aimed also at local governments with mayors of some of the biggest cities in the world, Seoul, Paris, and so on. So hope we can see you, but international, building the international movement has been so important for us as well.
Thank you, Nancy. Great.
Not only non solo le cooperative sociali sono social enterprise, ma anche una nuova forma di cooperative che abbiamo oggi in Italia che si chiamano cooperative di comunità, e svelerò il segreto, dirò che cosa sono domani mattina durante il mio workshop.
There are not only the social cooperatives, but there's a new kind of cooperative new in Italy that are called community cooperatives. She's going to talk about the community cooperatives tomorrow morning in her speaking.
Il segreto del successo della cooperazione in Emilia Romagna. La cittadinanza è molto attiva, si fa molto sentire, interviene molto, e molto spesso questi gruppi di cittadini formano non profit organization che poi si trasformano in cooperazione sociale.
The secret of the success of cooperatives in Emilia Romagna, which is the region of Italy, is the fact that the citizens are very active and very the solidarity is very active, and they get together for non-profit organization. They're very full of initiatives, and that's the secret of the active population of that region.
Si trasformano in cooperative sociali e anche in cooperative di lavoro, i gruppi di cittadini.
So this can create social cooperatives and work cooperatives with all the citizens of that region.
Il secondo motivo è la grande imprenditorialità delle persone che vivono in Emilia Romagna. In Emilia Romagna è nata la Ferrari. Do you know Ferrari? Yeah. Or in Emilia Romagna è nata la Ducati e così via.
Emilia Romagna is full of entrepreneurs. Ferrari is the main example of that, but there's not only Ferrari, there's thousands of entrepreneurs like Ducati, and that's the secret of that region.
Quindi è una terra di imprenditori, di intrapresa, diciamo così. Un altro motivo è che la cooperazione in Italia nasce da tre ideologie: il comunismo, il liberismo e l'ideologia cattolica.
The other reason of success is that everything starts from three concepts: communism, the liberalism, and the Catholic. What was the third?
E questi tre movimenti danno origine a tre leghe delle cooperative: la Lega delle Cooperative, Conf Cooperative e AGC.
So there's three different kind of cooperatives according to those three different currents and concepts.
E in Emilia Romagna sono forti tutti e tre: liberali, comunista e cattolica.
All three of them are very strong: liberal, communist and Catholic.
In my country, and e vivono insieme comunismo e cattolicesimo, comunismo e liberismo, e tutti costruiscono una società migliore.
So, cooperative wise, they all live together in symbiosis: communism, Catholicism, and liberalism. It's a unique example of this region, in this region of Italy.
Recentemente abbiamo tentato di unire le tre leghe nell'alleanza cooperativa italiana, ma ancora non ce l'abbiamo fatta.
They've been trying to unify the three cooperatives, but it's a very hard job until now because of different interests in the three.
E così continuiamo a farci competizione e a crescere.
So there is a competition, but it's a correct competition, so they all grow because of that.
Thank you.
Para nosotros, los problemas que hemos tenido que enfrentar, creo que no es un tema que haya finalizado. Cada día estamos enfrentando diferentes dificultades.
So for us, the problems haven't ended, would not end. We still facing them.
Pero creo que temas como financiamiento ha sido siempre un aspecto que se ha tenido que luchar. Y los gobiernos sucesivos de El Salvador, hasta el año 2009, tenían casi cerradas las puertas para el movimiento cooperativo.
So, finance have always been a struggle and a big fight. And the governments that have succeeded till 2009 have closed the doors to finance to us.
Es a partir del 2009 hacia acá que hay cierta apertura para recursos. Otro tema que ha sido importante que hemos tenido que ir superando es el tema de formación técnica, porque el contexto de nosotros es que muchos cooperativistas, algunos son analfabetas, no pueden leer, entonces se complica más para avanzar en los procesos.
So, since 2009 to now, we have resolved a little bit that problem, but the other problem we have is the technological. We need to advance with technologies, and for us it's hard because learning is an issue. Because a lot of our co-op members are illiterate, so it is difficult.
Otro de las dificultades que hemos tenido que enfrentar es el cómo organizar el mercado, porque eso está controlado por el sistema capitalista, y entonces para la economía alternativa, para las cooperativas, hay que sortear o avanzar, pero cuesta mucho, porque es un tema que lo tienen controlado las grandes transnacionales.
So organized, the market is organized in a capital domination, so capitalism is an issue. So if we are talking about this economy, it's hard because is an alternative, and the alternative is not there because capitalism.
Por ejemplo, ahora una de nuestras cooperativas están participando en ventas hacia el Estado en un programa de semillas que se entregan hacia los productores, pero tuvimos mucha presión para que el Estado no le compre a las cooperativas y que no haya cierto mecanismo que faciliten eso, porque nosotros tenemos un tratado de libre comercio con el norte, con Estados Unidos, y ahí dice que están las reglas establecidas, que no se puede ir utilizar otros mecanismos.
So the other thing is we have trying to sell seeds to the state as producers, but it's a lot of pressure to not make that happen because to facilitate that mechanism has been an issue because they already have this free trade agreements with the North, and that has made it mandatory impossible.
Entonces, otro que hemos logrado posicionar es que las cooperativas y la organización es una alternativa para lograr mejorar la economía de las familias campesinas, y el gobierno actual tiene ya en su programa de gobierno ciertas acciones para fortalecer el movimiento cooperativo, que para nosotros eso es un triunfo, porque en los gobiernos anteriores eso no existía, estaban como invisibilizadas el movimiento cooperativo agrícola, porque el financiero tiene otro tipo de desarrollo más avanzado.
So, for us co-ops, is organized, we have win, I feel, is a win, that we have a better economy in this government because co-ops are a better alternative for homes. And now the government is giving us a little bit more opportunity to have that happen. So, because we before have been invisibilized as a movement.
Thank you. Although, Oscar, you jumped ahead sort of to the next question, which is current struggle. So just to remind you, this question is what critical factors led to the success?
Okay, well, success is always relative, but I think that there a critical factor for the success, I guess, at the national level, is that the Cuban Revolution never passed away, never transitioned to capitalism like so many others. We went through a very deep economic crisis in the 90s with the collapse of the Soviet Union. So we pulled up our britches and we survived. And that was the first success, survival under so many difficult circumstances, including a tightening of the US blockade against Cuba, which has hurt and continues to hurt because we still have very many limitations in our economy given impossibility of use of the US dollar and a lot of other constraints that are still in place with the US embargo. But at some point in time, I think the people reacted and the leadership heard the demands of the people. And these demands were, we want socialism, but we want a prosperous, sustainable, solidary, and democratic socialism. And basically, this leadership, which is still the generation in power and is giving up power in the next 5 years because of age and because generations pass, is guiding the country in that direction. It's not without resistance. It's not without struggle. Not without a lot of pressures from inside and outside. But I think that the fact that we're still there, the revolution survived, and it's looking toward a new stage, a new moment in our history, is a major factor. In case of our particular project, one of the factors, a main factor, was the fact that we were able to form an international consortium of people that were active in a social and solidarity economy in Latin America, in Canada, in Spain, in the US, and we have established through 9 years of work many exchanges, many opportunities to have events and to Cubans participate internationally, and other international people participate in Cuba. And I think that cross-fertilization has helped us understand better our own needs and also the possibilities for the future.
Thank you. With time to spare. So the last question is, what are some of the current struggles that you face?
Well, the big challenge for us is really the question of scaling up, moving out of the margins into the mainstream so that the approach of the social and solidarity economy becomes a reflex in the economy as opposed to an exception. That means refusing that because to a certain extent, as we grow, some people, neoliberal idolists say, oh, it's good what you're doing because basically you're picking up the pieces of the mess we've made. And we refuse to do that. Of course we're working with, picking up the pieces, but we want the whole cake. We don't want just pieces of what they've left behind. We evaluate, and because of this framework legislation, we will have official statistics that we're about 10% of the economy. So we've got to grow. That means access to capital. That means getting into manufacturing more than we are, getting into natural resources. I could go on and on. The other major challenge is the question of, we have to be able to articulate what is this new economic development model that we're talking about, putting all the pieces together. Our mission as a chantier, which brings together grassroots enterprises and communities and so on, and social movements and First Nations, is a new economic development model. And contributing to by growing our enterprises and our initiatives and so on. But how is it all going to fit together? Because we feel that there are a lot of people out there, our population, our communities in Quebec and across the world, that know that this system, neoliberalism, and as I say, even the IMF is saying it, has not worked, is not working. We're going for an environmental disaster. I mean, I don't tell you all the problems with the existing system. So we have to work on articulating that in a clear way, concrete way, while we are building it at the same time. We're actually in the process of doing a two-year tour of all the regions of Quebec, with our regional, because we have regional polls in all the regions, to discuss in open meetings with young people, with elected officials, about what that new development model would look like. And that's what we'd like to share with you as well as the year, as time goes by. The last thing, and this is something new that we hadn't seen before, and perhaps it's a sign of the strength of the movement as it grows, is this incredible capacity for capitalism to co-opt the vocabulary that we're using. I mean, just think of Uber and the sharing economy. What are they sharing? Come on! So the idea is we've got to be able to show a real shared economy. Shared means collectively owned. And this whole idea of social enterprise and social entrepreneurs that are these individuals that are going to get rich, of course, because that's important, but they're going to change the world as well. Well, maybe they might, but we think that ownership matters and that community and collective ownership is the basis on which we have to build a solidarity economy. So all this... So those are the challenges, and that's what we got to work on together.
Thank you.
Anche noi, anche in Italia, abbiamo in realtà molti difetti. E è chiaro che il capitale umano è la cosa più importante per sviluppare anche il fenomeno della cooperazione dell'impresa sociale. Quindi dobbiamo lavorare sul capitale umano.
Okay. Even in Italy we have a lot of problems, but the major one is the what you would call the human capital, the human resources, education, which we have to work a lot about this.
Infatti la maggior parte delle persone pensa che abbiamo un solo modo per fare economia e non più modi di fare economia, un po' come diceva Nancy. E quindi noi dobbiamo insegnarlo fin dalle scuole.
So as Nancy was saying before, a lot of people think that there is just one way of doing economy, not different alternative ways and valid ways. So that's what we have to teach. In to people's education from high school on.
Esiste una sorta di pensiero dominante, una sorta di isomorfismo culturale che porta solo a insegnare il profitto. avuto come obiettivo e non come mezzo.
In the generations of today, there is a sort of what it's called isomorphismo, which is isomorphism, which is a concept of doing economy just for profit, which this is what we are working to try to modify.
Yes, I would like to explain that profit is the objective, and for cooperative is the instrument. Okay.
Okay. She was just saying that the concept is that to do economy for profit, this is a goal, but in the cooperative is a tool, it's not a goal.
Quindi dobbiamo spiegare una pluralità di modelli di business a tutti, appunto a tutti i livelli della formazione.
So the challenge is to explain that there are different models of business in the creation of an economy, not just one.
In particolare modelli che hanno come missione sia la sociale che l'economica e hanno una governance multi-stakeholdership e hanno molta attenzione all'accountability sia interna che esterna.
So in particular the models that have a sustainability which is not only economic but social sustainability and a lot of attention for the social aspect of the people who are working in this cooperative.
A multi-stakeholdership?
Right.
Three-way, different mission, multi-stakeholdership and accountability interna ed esterna.
Okay, accountability internal to the cooperative.
E per fare questo stiamo cercando di organizzare con le più grosse centrali cooperative la formazione universitaria. Attualmente c'è solo il mio corso che si chiama Management and Social Economy in Italia, ma non a caso è in Emilia Romagna, ma abbiamo tre master, uno a Trento, uno a Milano e uno a Bologna.
With this purpose, they have three master courses, which
only three
for the time being, which one is in Emilia-Romagna, one is in Trento, another one is in Bologna, whose goal is to explain the diversity of the social economy concepts.
E noi dobbiamo cercare di aumentarli, di avere più enti che formano il capitale sociale delle nostre organizzazioni.
So they are fighting to increase the number of these courses to explain the concept and to
E in più dobbiamo fare anche executive master per chi già lavora nella cooperazione per spiegare un modo diverso di fare management.
Of course, even for people who already are working in cooperatives, we have to organize master courses to update their knowledge on the cooperative management.
Perché dobbiamo evitare che i manager che vengono dal for profit, molto spesso capita che alcuni manager vengano presi dal for profit per la cooperazione, non cambino la nostra mission.
Sometimes happens that people are coming from a profit economy companies, and we have to be careful so that they don't change the mission of the cooperative by working there with that concept of usual concept of profit.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. And I'm going to ask the speakers to keep an eye on the timekeeper.
Bueno, nuestras luchas en este minuto quiero hablar. Antes dije que soy miembro de Vía Campesina y tenemos unas luchas en Centroamérica, bueno, y en el mundo, porque Vía Campesina es un movimiento mundial que tiene una membresía de alrededor de 200 millones en el mundo. Estamos en todas las regiones prácticamente, pero en Centroamérica estamos luchando por el acceso a la tierra. Muchos campesinos están muriendo en Honduras porque no tienen tierra y están luchando por acceder a ella. Lo mismo pasa en Guatemala también, muchos hermanos campesinos han sido asesinados y son países que están criminalizando la lucha. También estamos luchando contra el extractivismo que está desplazando a las comunidades indígenas de sus territorios. Y eso es una lucha de Villa Campesina Internacional porque, como dije antes, hablamos de soberanía alimentaria, pero no puede haber soberanía alimentaria si no tenemos tierra, si no tenemos agua, si no tenemos financiamiento.
So, as I said before, I'm part of Villa Campesina, and we want to talk specifically about the fight that we have in Central America. We are, of course, a bigger international movement, and we are everywhere. We have more than 200 million members everywhere in the world. But we want to say that the fight we have right now is land access. And a lot of our people, peasants, are dying. But they're not just dying, they're being killed for the fight. Is a lot of people are dying again. They're killed because of the fight for land access in Honduras and in Guatemala. Our brothers and sisters are being criminalized because they're part of a movement and they're fight. We also are fighting against the extractive economy. We're always talking about food sovereignty, but we don't have access. So the access is access to land, access to money, and
water.
Access to water.
Entonces, 30 segundos. Estas luchas también por el 2 minutos. Por el cambio climático también. Nosotros decimos que los campesinos pueden enfriar el planeta porque los monocultivos generan una serie de problemas que estamos enfrentando ahora, muchos desplazados ambientales, porque se está priorizando el capitalismo prioriza la acumulación de las ganancias, desplazando las comunidades, y son luchas que nosotros también tenemos. Pero también estamos trabajando por la formación de activistas agroecológicos. Tenemos escuelas en Centroamérica, en Sudamérica y en Asia y en Europa, donde estamos también formando activistas para un nuevo mundo. Esas son parte de nuestras luchas que estamos haciendo.
So we also fight against climate change. Our peasants also have been displaced, environmentally displaced. But we also do a lot of education. We have agroecologist schools and activism, and we have them in Central America and Asia and Europe.
Okay, entonces nuestra lucha alrededor de la parte económica, pues es una diversidad, las cooperativas, pero hay comunidades indígenas que no les interesa las cooperativas, quieren autonomía de sus territorios, pues también es su derecho, y trabajamos porque esas comunidades tengan su propia forma de desarrollar su economía y respetar también esos derechos de estos pueblos originarios.
So, yes, our fight is economic, but as co-ops, some of the peasants are indigenous, and we want to respect that. And we want to respect the ways of living, and by that, we also want to respect the way their economies. Thank you.
Being the last in the line has its problems, right? So I'm supposed to tell you the challenges in 3 minutes, and I'm gonna tell you seven challenges in 3 minutes, which is a challenge in itself. So the first challenge is we need to scale down state command over the public, the communal, and the private property. So the state is too involved in determining forms of property that are not really public or that really belong. The decisions have to be made more at the local level. We need to scale up the social property, the co-ops, the associations. There's now more recognition of the properties of associations, religious organizations, NGOs, Cuban NGOs, and this is an opportunity to play a bigger role. And that is also scaling up civil society as a space to promote social change and to strengthen socialism. We have to scale up the mechanisms for participation, for citizen participation. They are too formal, they are too boxed in, and we need other more creative. You guys are doing a lot of different things in this area that we could learn from. We need to scale up workers' democracy in the distribution of the surplus. This is a huge issue because socialism is not only defined by the ownership of the means of production and by the predominance of planning over the market, it's also defined by the distribution of the surplus. And that has to do with the producers playing a bigger role in the distribution of the surplus. We have to scale up transparency and accountability in a society that has used control of information in part as a national security issue. So when you go to the Canadian embassy and you ask for a list of the Canadian companies that operate in Cuba, the Canadians won't give it to you because they're afraid of US retaliation. And this is general because we have faced that situation, and the lack of transparency, the lack of accountability has sort of sneaked into that concept of national security. And finally, we have to scale up democratic socialism. We have to make Cuba even more social and more solidary than it is.
Thank you. Thank you so much to all the speakers. And I really apologize, we do not have time for discussion and questions. But I'm sorry that I had to be such an oppressor and take away your freedom to talk, but that was my role. So thank you again. Thank you again. Let's give them all a round of applause. Thanks.
Let's give it up, please, for our panelists and our interpreters and our moderator. So I see it happening. Yes, thank you. Folks came from around the world to be here with us today. Thank you. Thank you. So just a couple of things about time. Time is this funny thing, right? It's both small and it's elastic. So we did start 15 minutes late. So we expect we may, because we think our program is worth it, to go 15 over. What we do encourage is everybody to take care of yourselves. It looks like folks are in the way that you need, and really appreciate your graciousness and your flexibility. And three of those keynote speakers have workshops tomorrow, if you would like to dive deeper into what they said. We have another panel coming up. We're about to do a transition. Each of this is not intended to be the full movie of people's work, but rather the small two-minute trailer, because this work is not just about this conference, but goes on beyond that, right? And we're in it for the long haul. So this is to help you identify who you want to get with and learn about their work later on. So just to release some of the pressure on that, both the speakers and the listeners, that we're in this together for a while, okay? Yeah? So we're going to bring up the amazing NEC board member, Ed Whitfield, to give you some musical stylings on his flute while we transition to the Buffalo panel. So let's give it up for Ed. We're going to set him up here for a couple minutes. Encourage you to enjoy the non-talk time and the musical stylings, and we will then get the rest of the panel set up. And please take care of yourself. Know that when the music stops, the second panel will start, whether you are in your seats or not. So thank you, everybody, for your flexibility and your grace. Thank you. Ed. Those who know Ed knows that he is a Renaissance man and is also one of the best storytellers, a best guitarist, and an amazingly sharp, sharp strategist. So thank you, Ed, for that. So we are going to have talk about how new economy happens at different scales. And for this Buffalo panel, Sam McGavern, who is with the Partnership for the Public Good and with Open Buffalo's Innovation Lab, will be leading us through this next panel. Thank you, Sam.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. On behalf of the Crossroads Collective, I want to welcome you to this panel and introduce you to our panelists. We have Rebecca Williams. She's the Youth Education Director for Massachusetts Avenue Project. Khadija Hussein is a mobile market specialist with the Massachusetts Avenue Project and a future biomedical engineer, if I understand right. Andrew Del Monte is a founder of Cooperation Buffalo. Rebecca Newberry is the executive director of the Clean Air Coalition of Western New York. Clark Gawker is the policy director at Push Buffalo. And India Walton is a member of the Community First Alliance and one of the inaugural graduates of the Open Buffalo Emerging Leaders Program. So I'm just going to make a few remarks and then turn it over to them. So here in Buffalo, the wounds of the extractive economy are open and bleeding. You can see them in the statistics about our region. You can see them in the fact that half of the children in the city of Buffalo are living in poverty, that the unemployment rate for African Americans in this region is three times that of whites. You can see it in the fact that we have the sixth worst racial segregation in the whole nation, that 80% of African Americans live in high poverty neighborhoods compared to 10% of whites in our region. But beyond the statistics, you can see the wounds of the extractive economy in our boarded up houses, in our vacant lots, in the neighborhoods that we abandoned in order to build new subdivisions on our former farmlands. You can see those wounds in the brownfields that private industry left behind for public to clean up. You can see them in the heating bills that are breaking the backs of tenants living in poorly insulated, poorly repaired apartments. You can see them in our courts, in our jails, where African Americans, despite being only 14% of our county's population, represent 42% of our arrests and 60% of our prison sentences. You can see them in children being diagnosed with lead poisoning at a higher rate here than in Flint, Michigan. But in Buffalo, as I hope you've seen this weekend, we also have a proud history of resistance and resilience. And this is a place where you can also see the green shoots of the new economy thrusting up through the rubble of the old. You can see those green shoots quite literally in our community gardens and our urban farms, but you can also see them in policy victories being won around energy democracy and just transitions. You can see those green shoots in an unprecedented collaboration across racial and geographic lines to build a movement for things like community benefits and community control of public land. And most important of all, you can see those green shoots in the young leaders that are emerging to build that new economy with all the power of their minds and the passion in their hearts. So now I want to introduce you to six of those amazing new leaders, and they'll give you some snapshots of the new economy in Buffalo, and we'll start with Rebecca Williams.
Thank you. I have 2 minutes to talk about food justice in our city, and so I will do that through the framework of my experience. And then I'm going to pass it on to the lovely young woman next to me, whose story is very beautiful, and I'm excited to hear it again myself. So although I would love to speak with you about the Black Panthers and how they had breakfast in the classroom in the Head Start programs throughout Buffalo, that was before my time, so I can't tell that story. So 1998, there was the Wegmans Five arrest. A union worker from California traveled to Buffalo to ask us to stand in solidarity with the workers there who Driscoll Strawberries was spraying pesticides right on the fields, and the workers had no rights to organize. So standing in solidarity with them, there was a protest out in the suburbs here where five of us were arrested. The actual reason of that arrest, though, was had to do actually with police brutality. A young woman from the west side of Buffalo, a young Lebanese woman who I dragged along with me to the protest, was brutalized by a cop who came all pumped up and ready to deal something out. So that kicked off her being brutalized, and that actually was the point of solidarity that myself and the three suits that were arrested, that's why we were arrested. So couple years later, I would jump forward to parents organizing in a public Montessori school on the east side around growing gardens and trying to connect some of the benefits of children being able to get their hands in the dirt and then actually being able to bring that food that they grew into the cafeterias and learn how to prepare it themselves and learning all the challenges surrounding that. Additionally, at that time, I lived on the east side with my newborn son, who's in the audience over there, and began to be involved with land reclamation on the east side and learned the challenges of organizing block clubs and talking with Black folks, talking with other Black folks about organizing around community gardens and market gardens and some of the issues surrounding land reclamation here in Buffalo. That led me to meet an organization that's become my home and my family, which is Massachusetts Avenue Project. And they are my people, one, because they come from the same outlook that I do, which is that you go to the community first and you ask the community what it wants. So before I introduce a young woman from the community that of young people who we employ at Massachusetts Avenue Project, I'll just say a little tidbit more of jumping ahead into 2016, a colleague of ours at the University at Buffalo, Dr. Raja, published a piece called Rust Belt Radicals. And really what it talks about is how those of us in our communities, in our neighborhoods, we were doing the work before the policies were in place. And we kind of blazed that trail in terms of trying to draw along the policies. Now, here we are today, and our green code, you know, includes planning around urban agriculture and allows for chickens in our city. But there's so much more work to do. And I just also want to tie in quickly, also flashing ahead just to a new organizing that is going on where people of color in our communities are really, young people are coming together around some of these injustices and just recognizing that connection between food justice and race issues. And those, if you come to the food justice tracks, you'll hear a lot more about that. So hopefully we'll touch on that again tomorrow. But just in that, the work that we're doing in our cities right now with food justice and at MAP has to look first at people of color and have them share kind of what is necessary and what is working and the direction to go. And so with that said, I'm going to turn it over to Khadija, who is one of our young leaders.
Hi, everybody. My name is Khadija. I was born in a small village that's called Dadaab, Kenya. I mean, no, I was born in the city, which is Nairobi, Kenya, but like raised in Dadaab, Kenya, which is a smaller village where it's like not so like as well as the city. So it was a poor village too. In a village like back home, we were like thought to like everybody is brothers and sisters. I don't know if you guys ever work with like youth like around the world, and most like youth from Africa will call each other cousin, and they're always like every another African that they see, they're like, that's my cousin. Not because literally that's our cousin, but because we're like, our parents taught us that all of us are all brothers and sisters. So in Kenya, I didn't have much. Like growing up as a little girl, I didn't have a phone to play with. I didn't have a laptop or what we have here. Like we have a lot of different things here that can keep us, you know, doing, having fun and everything. At Kenya, all we had is family and our friends. That was our entertainment. So like in the village, it was a safe village too. No, everybody was trusted and we all knew each other since we were family. We would like, after dinner around like 7 o'clock, and we would eat dinner all together at the village too. We cook at the village, we do everything at the village because we are all family. So after 7 o'clock p.m., like we will go, it gets a little dark and we will go out and playing with our friends like what, till 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the night. And like, we didn't have school there. We didn't have the opportunity to take school because it was so, everything was expensive there and it was tough because we lived in a poor village. And couple years after my oldest brother was born, maybe around 1996, my parents decided that they should register for like being one of the people that goes to America. And my mom, when we did get selected back in like 2003, we were told that we were gonna go to America in 2005 of March. When we was going, like getting ready to go to the airport and everything, when we did arrive in America, we was landed in Tampa, Florida, and my mom always told us that we came here for a better life. So take every like opportunity that's every positive opportunity you can. And from there, like I always took her words very, it meant, like I took it serious because I know how much it would mean to my mom that we do like accomplish what she wanted for us. And like she said, I brought you here for a reason. So don't make a fool out of me and like, you know, show people that you like why the reason you came here. So as we moved to Buffalo 9 months later after we lived in Tampa, Florida. And Tampa was a little, the weather was kind of like similar to back in Kenya. It was both hot. So I didn't have a problem. So when I came to Buffalo, it was winter and it was snowing. And like, I was wondering when we were on the airplane, I'm like, mom, what's that white stuff? And like, she didn't really knew either. She's like, I don't know, this is America. Maybe it's like, and like my mom, and like when I got off the airplane, I was very tiny too and short. And my siblings started laughing at me, you know, until my younger brother that laughed first fell too, and then I started laughing. Like, it was freezing. The weather, I couldn't take it. So I lived here and everything. I started learning the American culture and everything. And growing up, when I got to high school, I tried different things. I started working on MAP, Massachusetts Avenue Project with Rebecca. And it taught me a lot about youth leadership. And like right now I'm a small market specialist. So I bring healthy produce to food desert areas. And through MAP, I got involved with YAC, which is Youth Advisor Council. Now its name is HYPE. And that helps teaches youth to bring healthier food to schools, Buffalo Public Schools. And then also through MAP, I got involved with community health workers, which teaches youth to like be involved into their community. So, you know, like I never thought 10 years from 2005 2005, I never thought I would be this type of leader, you know, and I graduated last month as an early graduate junior and like, you know, so. So why am I saying this? It's because I feel like our youth should be taught and to be more involved into everything. Like my mom always told us, be involved into the most, like the positive opportunities you get, always take it. So as like tonight, I would say like our youth should be taught more about agriculture and all the leadership roles, because I noticed in America, most of our farmers are older senior citizens. If they pass on, who, like, if our youth are not thought right now, who would like take their place, you know?
So I'm going to talk to you about Cooperation Buffalo, but to do that, I'm going to start in the spirit of remembering that I'm a human being, not just a human doing. I'll talk a little bit about me. So I was born and raised four blocks away from where we're all sitting today in Buffalo here. Spent most of my life here. I come from a father who's an Italian, descended from Italian immigrants who came here 109 years ago. To Buffalo and lived and worked and started their own businesses and operated their own businesses in a district downtown that is now called Canalside, and there's lots of big oversized Adirondack chairs and sailing that happens there. But back then it was known as the infected district, and it was a really rough place to be, and folks lived in extreme poverty down there. And it was sort of really looked down on by the Buffalo aristocracy, if that gives you a sense of, you know, the value that that our system often places on the labor that is needed to make a city great like this. And then on, my mother is a hardworking college grad who entered into a profession that is overrun and controlled by very aggressive, manipulative, awful white men, and has struggled through that her whole life and brings those struggles home every day. And was eventually fired when it became more economically advantageous to hire two people for the price of her, and has since had to go through some real interesting personal changes too because of that. And that has never felt right, and there's something that really doesn't feel right personally, and I'm sure that's why all of us are here, about a system that, that puts capital above people. So it's important for me to remember that that's why I'm here. And then why we do the work of cooperative development here in Buffalo. Buffalo's been through some moments when this has been more or less sort of at the fore. There's some new worker cooperatives in the room tonight that have started recently in Buffalo. There was a surge in the 80s and 90s here that you might have heard a little bit about earlier in session. And then and the cooperative history that, that is documented well in Buffalo goes all the way back to the late 1920s when a group that had varying names, but at one point it was called the Cooperative, or the Buffalo Cooperative Economic Society, headed by a man by the name of Dr. Ezekiel Nelson. And it was particularly used as a way to lift people of color out of poverty and as a racial solidarity and mutual self-help model. And that's part of the lens that we wanted to bring to sort of restarting cooperative development structurally here in Buffalo through Cooperation Buffalo. So,
Andrew, can you make sure you keep your...
Yes, sorry. So we try to frame this as using organizing tools, the toolkit of the organizer, to do business development. So our mission is to mobilize workers to achieve economic security through cooperative business ownership, the strategies we employ, popular education, common organizing tactic just to get out there and teach people and learn with people in community about what it means to be able to own things, and for many of the people that, that we encounter, it's that's something that isn't necessarily even understood or common. Standard business training, skill sharing amongst other entrepreneurs and cooperatives, incubation of businesses that are particularly going to generate wealth and power in communities that are most affected by inequality. We're forming a peer-to-peer network that's going to provide mutual support for and from and by the businesses that are coming through our incubation process, hopefully making some of us developers who started this work obsolete at a certain point. And then what we've really been doing for 2 or 3 years at this project, myself and two other founders of Cooperation Buffalo, has been the ecosystem development, figuring out where we sit in our broad pool of partners and other resources that are already out there, and even how we can embed ourselves in traditional economic development structures and use those to our advantage to achieve the means that, that we're after. So I, for my day job, I work at a small business development center here in Buffalo, pushing the needle slowly in a direction where we talk about cooperatives and putting people first and social enterprise tactics and those sorts of things at a place that is really, you know, tends to be very capital focused as a day-to-day operation. So I guess we do all of this with the emphasis that ownership really matters. As some folks said earlier, I think in certain communities, ownership is vital. And then we do this in solidarity and collaboration with the organizing movements that are already here, and I think that's super vital to what we're doing and why we're doing it. And I want to leave just by saying I love all the names we come up with for our movements here in Buffalo. So we have to push Buffalo, we have to open Buffalo, and then we have to cooperate as Buffalo to build the thing that we want to see next. So.
Okay, it's my turn. My name is Rebecca. I work at the Clean Air Coalition of Western New York. We are an environmental justice and public health organization here, and we work to support communities that are sick and ill because of where they work, where they live, how much money they make, or you know, the color of their skin. So I actually never thought I'd be an environmentalist. I still don't know if I am, so don't be mad. I grew up about 30 minutes south of here in a really small town called Colden, New York. I lived up on a hill. There was a lot more snow there than there is in the city. and my mom was a school teacher. So she was the breadwinner of my family. We relied on her income. And she was very, very active in her union. So most of my background is actually around labor and working people. Because that's where I grew up and that's how I grew up. I can say honestly that I was raised in the labor movement. My mom eventually went on to be the president, the first president of her local, which is an affiliate of the New York State United Teachers, and we're very proud of her for that. Very proud of her for that. And I think the lesson, one of the lessons that I really learned from my mother that has started showing up now, as I find myself in this role, in my life is really around the power of relationships. When my mother was diagnosed, she was diagnosed with, it's called primary CNS lymphoma, about 4 years ago, and I was her primary caretaker, and it's a severe type of lymphoma of the brain. So she actually went from being fiercely independent, to not being able to walk, not being able to speak within 48 hours. So who showed up? The folks that she was in struggle with showed up. And so when we were, you guys can clap for that. They showed up. So we, my brother and I were in Roswell, and it was person after person after person after person. Teachers who she fought for their jobs, teachers who she advocated for, teachers who she lobbied for, people who could have lost their job or were having problems at home, but she advocated for them on behalf of the union. Those were the folks that showed up. And I think I've been asked, I think today, to speak a little bit about our just transition work in Tonawanda. We are working with labor to figure out how to succeed, how to prosper, and how to survive after our coal plant in Tonawanda is closing. And I've been asked about, I would say about a dozen times over the last, 9 hours. How long have we been here together? I don't know. I wasn't here yesterday, so. About how do we scale this, right? How do we scale it up? What is the advice? And I don't have it for y'all, right? I don't know if there ever will be one solution that fits every community. I don't know if there ever is gonna be, you know, a model that we're supposed to replicate. But what I do know and what I've been learning and consistently reminded here is relationships are way more important than the issue. And we've been able to build very, very significant relationships with the folks that work in these plants, people that work in the public sector whose jobs are at risk because of the tax revenue these plants pay. And we've been able to build with them. And we've been able to build wonderful relationships between literally the folks that live across the street from the plant and the folks that represent the guys in the plant. I have 30 seconds left, and that's wonderful because I'm running out of things to say. So I think one of the biggest learnings, and I think one of the things that I'm very proud of, really is that opportunity that I had growing up, and understanding that there needs to be points of joining. And when we're thinking about the type of economy we want to build, we also have to keep in mind that we're in this reality together, and it might not be our fault, right? It might not be our fault that jobs are being lost or we can't make a living, right? But it is our problem. And the only way we're going to overcome that is by establishing actual relationships with each other and showing up. So that's my 2 minutes, 4 minutes. Thanks.
Good evening, everybody. Quick show of hands, who was fortunate enough to jump on the bus to the west side, to the green development zone this afternoon? Cool. Thank you very much. So again, I'm Clark Gawker with Push Buffalo. For those on that tour this afternoon, you probably were introduced to a lot of the affordable housing development projects that Push has taken on since our start about 10 years ago. You maybe viewed a couple of the job training houses that we've also led. And the kind of the snapshot or anecdote I want to share with you all kind of relates to, you know, one of those eureka moments that we may all have where kind of in broad daylight or kind of under our noses, we say, holy shit, what just happened? We just kind of, you know, stumble on something that we think could be transformative. And that happened to us a couple years ago. We had secured funding for a small five-unit affordable housing development project and said, we're the developers of this project. And it's a role we'd played in a couple prior projects, but it really hadn't dawned on us until that project that as a developer, we could impose standards on ourselves that we would do if we were kind of chasing after other developers in town as a community organizing entity. And so we did just that. We talked to our members, and we came up with a set of community benefit standards that we wanted to hold ourselves accountable to as property developers. Chief among those were the creation of living wage, local construction jobs for neighborhood residents, and for the sons and daughters of our members. And so how that kind of got operationalized, we used the leverage that we had as a developer, and we knew we were going to be putting this construction project out to bid, so we wrote in the bid documents a requirement to contract with one of our subsidiary organizations to use us as a labor provider for that project. And we said, and it was a modest kind of requirement that we wrote into the bid documents. We said, the winning bidder, you'll contract with our organization for the services of 3 construction laborers. And so that the project went out to bid. One of the larger developers in town won the bid. And I remember this vividly. We're sitting down at the construction meeting to kind of kick off the project. And we got to the point of the project where we said, oh, remember this agreement that was kind of these standards that were put in place in this document. Lo and behold, they hadn't even read that. It was kind of news to them. But at the same time, they also weren't, it wasn't shocking. They weren't opposed to it. It was just like, just kind of standard business. And so that was kind of surprising and I think empowering and at the same time, and allowed us to create what we now call a community hiring hall, which we see as kind of a transitional institutional form that can really serve as a bridge between the old economy and the new economy. I think it's powerful at this very moment in time in Buffalo, because a lot of the economic development activity within the housing sector is happening in non-unionized segments of that industry, where there aren't good jobs, where developers and general contractors are dependent on temporary labor agencies, contingent labor that as we know, don't look out for their workers' best interests. So we felt like we could fill a gap. We could essentially be a high road temp agency for construction laborers, ensuring that the men and women in our community had priority access to jobs that paid a family sustaining wage, that provided paid time off benefits, as well as employer sponsored health care. So Last summer at this time, we had 18 men of color employed in positions making $14 to $15 an hour with that package of benefits. And we're kind of at a point now where the model continues. And I think just quickly, with the time I have left, just some lessons learned. There is some tension in that because we are providing a service to developers that are transforming neighborhoods across Buffalo in ways that we don't like, that are leading to the gentrification of certain neighborhoods. So that's a tension that we're wrestling with currently. Another tension is when news broke of what we were doing, that was agitational for our partners and our brothers and sisters in organized labor, in the building trades. But in a good way, it brought us to a table with several building trades unions to have a conversation about pipelines into apprenticeship programs, opportunities to create direct entry with, you know, the assistance of the Department of Labor. So those conversations are ongoing. So I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Thanks, Clark. India.
Hello, everyone. My name is India, and I'm going to stand up because the way my nerves are set up, I don't do well sitting still. I just want to congratulate all of you. You've lasted this long. I realize I'm probably the last thing in between you and your meal and your beer and your music, so I'm going to try and be brief and try and keep it interesting. So I was born in Buffalo. I was raised in Buffalo on the other side of Main Street, you know, the side with the red line drawn around it, where everything that came into the area went to the other side. So where we saw the west side being developed and North Buffalo being very affluent, we consistently saw in my neighborhood the divestment from our communities, where people couldn't get bank loans to start small businesses, where people couldn't get mortgages, where the city of Buffalo had land that was city owned where the grass would grow waist high because no one was maintaining the land. As an adult, I became a registered nurse, a professional person, and I make a decent amount of money. But when I chose where I was going to live, I wanted to live in my community, among my people, to be an example of what could be done if you put your mind to it. So now I find myself living in the Fruit Belt. If you Google it, they'll tell you that it's the Buffalo Niagara Medical Campus, but it's not. It's the Fruit Belt. Those people have been in that neighborhood for the last 40 and 50 years, homeowners, not a neighborhood, but a community, a family of people who have been caring for one another when no one else did. Now we have this giant with anchor institutions like Kaleida Health, a $1 billion healthcare organization that employs more people in Western New York than anybody besides UB, who also happens to be a part of that BNMC problem that we have. So what I've been doing is working with Community First Alliance, which is a coalition of, I'm so sorry, I know I'm a fast talker, I apologize. It's a coalition of community-based organizations and organizers. I'm not an organizer, I'm just a mother. I'm concerned about my community, but we're working with the Partnership for Public Good, with Open Buffalo, with Push Buffalo. What Push has done on the west side, I want to see come into my neighborhood. One of the small, it's not really a small victory, but the most recent victory we had was we had the state of New York pass legislation that allows us to have a residential parking program in our neighborhood. This is the first time that this has been done in New York State. We're waiting for Governor Cuomo to sign off on it. So anybody here that is a resident of the state, call Andrew. Send him an email, a letter, make a Facebook post, tell somebody, call. And you pass this Buffalo parking legislation so that we don't have people who are 75 years old walking three blocks home. The Fruit Belt is an old neighborhood. There are not many houses with driveways. And the people are working on the medical campus, coming in from the suburbs, and they're parking in front of our houses. And it's unfortunate that they have to pay. But yeah, that's the world that we live in. Most recently, we are asking the city of Buffalo for these 200 plus city-owned lots. They are vacant. Nothing is on them. The land is valuable. That is the only leverage that we have as a community to make sure that developers do not come in, develop the land, and push us out. The median income in my neighborhood is $24,000 a year. A year, my rent is $1,200. No one who lives there can afford that. We need to have 100% community control over these lots so that we can demand that it stays affordable for the people who have been there, for the people who belong there, so that we can maintain some sense of diversity, of history in that community. And this last thing that I want to say, what I need in my community is for people to stop helping us and help us learn, bring us the tools and give us the skills to help ourselves.
Thank you. Thank you, India. Thank you, all the panelists. So technically, we have like 2 minutes left, but in the spirit of the real sharing economy, not the fake Uber sharing economy, we're going to share that with you and your dinner and give it right back to you. So all you need to do is thank the panelists, and then you get to go to dinner.
Hello, hello. Hey, y'all have a very, 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 very important role. So a lot of people obviously have left to go to dinner and take care of themselves. You all need to pass along a few announcements in your conversations over beer and dinner. Can you do that?